has easier adaptability to marginal land conditions, and it has higher cost of production than commodity crops. So its cost of production is in general higher than corn and other crops such as soybeans and wheat. So that's a little bit of the negative side. On the other hand, Miscanthus, so which is even taller than switchgrass, has higher yield potential than switchgrass, and which is approximately 10 tons per acre. It has less fertilizer and herbicide application than switchgrass. It is more profitable than switchgrass, but on the other hand, it has higher establishment costs than switchgrass. So in general, Miscanthus gives higher yield, higher profitability, but in the beginning, it has higher establishment cost. So biomass crop assistance program is a cost share program that was established in the 2008 Farm Bill to promote development of feedstock for biofuel production. And biomass crop assistance program provides funding up to 5 years in three different forms for the farmers. So it covers 75% of the establishment cost. It provides one-to-one match for harvesting and delivering costs for delivering biomass to a biorefinery. So it covers the cost of farmers for harvesting and delivering that crop to the biomass refinery. And it also pays a land rental payment if the land is approved by the project. And currently there are only 11 biomass crop assistance projects in the United States. And the 2007 prediction for cellulosic biofuel production for 2020 was 16 billion gallons per year. Now the actual cellulosic ethanol production happened to be 75 million gallons in 2022. So which is less than 1% of the target demand. So this is very important. So in 2007, people targeted cellulosic ethanol production to be 16 billion gallons. But as of now, it has been only 1% that is produced. So it has been very slow in the United States. So previous studies have focused on cost of production and marketing, market uncertainty for energy crops. The literature on adoption of new technologies show that even cost-effective or profitable technologies are not always adopted by farmers. Other socioeconomic factors such as off-farm income can also impact the adoption decision of farmers. So as of 2019, around 70% of the US farmhold households have either the operator, spouse, or both had off-farm work. So majority of the farmers in the United States have work that is outside of the farming area. And the share of off-farm income in farm household income rose from roughly 50% in 1960s to 82% in 2019. I think this is very important because this shows that majority of the farmers' income is coming from non-farm income. Okay, so in general, in the United States, for majority of the farmers, farm income is a minor income in their household income. So the objective of our study is to analyze the impact of off-farm employment and other socioeconomic factors on farmers' willingness to grow switchgrass and Miscanthus. So as an economist, we did an utility maximization problem, and we indicate the adoption decision if the utility from adopting these crops are higher than utility from not adopting these crops. So if the utility is less than, utility from adopting these crops is less than or equal to utility from non-adopting, then the farmer will decide not to adopt these crops. So our model predictions for the influence of off-farm employment on the adoption decision is like that. Farmers with seasonal off-farm employment are more likely to grow switchgrass and Miscanthus because of season of farm employment would provide additional capital for farmers, so they can use that additional capital on the cost of production for these new crops. On the other hand, if the farmer has a year-round off-farm employment, now the impact of year-round off-farm employment depends on whether the capital or the labor impact is bigger. Now, if the farmer has a year-round off-farm employment, they have additional capital that can be used for adopting these crops, but on the other hand, they have less time available. So that could have a negative impact. So overall impact will depend on which of these two effects are more influential. So the data, so we did a male survey of around 3,000 livestock farmers with land in two states, Iowa and Missouri, in spring of 2013. We did not include farmers with farm sales less than $10,000. The effective rate for our survey was 21%. And the problem with these studies is that we didn't have very reliable data on the crop yield, crop revenue, because it was not established and it's still not established. So we provided farmers with the USDA, US Department of Agriculture information sheets for switchgrass and miscanthus. And farmers were provided with a sample payment plan for switchgrass and miscanthus. So we just provide them a sample, an example of what would be like growing switchgrass and miscanthus in terms of financial returns. So when we look at the farmers' willingness to grow switchgrass and miscanthus in Missouri and Iowa, we see that majority of the farmers are not willing to grow these crops. For example, for switchgrass, only 15% of the farmers are willing to grow in Missouri, and around 20% are willing to grow in Iowa. For miscanthus, even this is lower. Around 10% of the farmers in Missouri are willing to grow, and again, around 8% of the farmers in Iowa are willing to grow miscanthus. So when you look at the farmers, they are not willing to grow these crops. So we did a data analysis, and I'm going to show you our results, econometric results. So here our dependent variable is farmers' willingness to grow switchgrass and miscanthus. So positive coefficient means farmers are more likely to grow these crops, and the negative coefficient means farmers are less likely to grow these crops. So when we look at the influence of off-farm employment, the base category is that farmer is not having off-farm employment. Now, what we can see is farm operators, if they have seasonal off-farm employment, they are more likely to grow miscanthus, so which is what we expected. The additional capital that's generated by seasonal off-farm employment can be used for adopting these crops. On the other hand, if the farm operator has year-round off-farm employment, they are less likely to grow switchgrass and miscanthus. So in that case, the labor or the time constraint becomes more influential. So the farmers who are working off the farm throughout the year are less likely to grow these crops. Now, when we look at the farm size, this is again important. The base category is for farm sales from $10,000 to $100,000 is the base category. So we see that larger farms are less likely to grow these crops. Okay. So what we see is it is the smaller farmers that are willing to grow these crops, and this of course have consequences for the industry. And when we look at the influence of education, here the base category is high school. What we see is farmers with bachelor degree or graduate degree are more likely to grow these crops. So it could be related to human capital. So the farmers who have higher human capital would be more likely to adopt new crops. And when we look at the crop production, this is very, again, important, because when in the beginning, like in 2007, when this bioenergy was bioenergy policies were developed in the United States, the policymakers assumed it is the corn growers, the large growers, would grow these crops, and then they can grow these crops on their marginal land, the land that is not very fertile for corn, they could be devoted for growing switchgrass and miscanthus. But when we look at the farmers, it is not the case. The corn growers are less likely to grow switchgrass or miscanthus. And again, hay growers, hay is like feed crops, okay, like alfalfa, okay? So the farmers who are growing hay are also less likely to grow switchgrass and miscanthus. But on the other hand, farmers who have pasture for animal feed are more likely to grow switchgrass and miscanthus. And lastly, the farmers who have erosion problem on their land are also more likely to grow miscanthus. Now, miscanthus, again, it is a perennial grass and it has roots, so it can help with the erosion problem. So when we look at our conclusion, since the importance of off-farm income is expected to increase in the future, programs and policies to promote adoption of energy crops need to take this into account. Farmers with year-round off-farm employment will not be the likely growers of switchgrass and miscanthus, but farmers with seasonal off-farm employment can be the potential adopters. Small farms and especially the ones that have pasture will be the likely growers of energy crops. Now, the implication of this is very important, okay? When you have the smaller farms that are growing these crops, the transportation costs are very important in cellulosic ethanol production. So when you have a farm that is located more than 100 miles away from the facility, then it becomes economically unfeasible. So with smaller farms, then you will have these transportation problems. And although farmers were provided with information sheets and the sample payment plan, there can still be a potential bias in our regression estimates as farmers may request other information to make actual adoption decision. So we encourage, I mean, we hope to make experimental studies. And I thank you for your attendance. So I can answer any questions that you might have.
Haluk Hocam, çok teşekkür ederiz. Gerçekten de biyokütle üretimi neden istendiği gibi artmıyor, onun arkasında esasında büyük pencereden bakınca görünmeyen çok küçük, çok etkili engellerimizin olduğunu gördük. Değerli katılımcılar, öncelikle şu anda anket değerlendirmek için açıldı. Görüşlerinizi bekliyoruz. Daha sonra da Haluk Hocamıza varsa katkılarınız, sormak istediğiniz bir soru, onları da bekliyoruz. Haluk Hocam, bu arada ben şeyi fark ettim. Missouri'nin Iowa'dan daha yatkın olduğunu dallı dalıya. Evet. Kat sayıları kaçırmadıysam.
Evet, çok doğru, doğru değil mi hocam?
Bir de bir şey vardı hocam. Bu arada tartışmayı açayım diye soru gelesiye kadar. Benim bildiğim kadarıyla Konya'da bir doktora tezi bitti bu dallı darı ile ilgili.
Dallı darı, evet hocam.
Bu kısımları da değerlendirdi sanki. Bir takım veriler var. Daha çok teknik, ekonomik yönlü değil. Haberiniz var mı diye soracaktım.
Evet hocam. Şöyle, ben ilk geldiğimde mesela dallı darı konusunda çalışmalara baktım. Biraz daha, yani şöyle, ülkemizde özellikle bu selüloz bazlı etanolun üretimi ve bunların rafineler tarafından benzin üretiminde kullanılması zorunluluğu getirilirse bunların, bu bitkilerin üretimi bizde de artabilir. Mesela Avrupa Birliği'nde bu konuda yaptırımlar olduğu için onları aslında hani Türkiye'de üretilip Avrupa Birliği'ne de ihraç edebiliriz. Benim aslında dikkati çekmek istediğim nokta bu. Yani Avrupa Birliği'nin bu getirdiği yasal zorunluluklardan dolayı ve onlarda da bunların üretiminin çok olmayışından dolayı, yani Türkiye burada bir gelir kazanabilir çiftçilerimiz açısından.
Evet Haluk Hocam, biliyorsun Türkiye'de bu adımı attı. Yani o bahsettiğin oranlarla ilgili kademeli bir geçiş deklare etti. Fakat uygulamaya aktarma konusunda nihayetinde taraflarda trade-off sıkıntısı yaşanınca o bahsettiğin o marjı, yani kotayı arttırma konusunda pek istenilen noktaya gelemedik çeşitli sebeplerle. Ama katılıyorum, bu bir fırsattır. Her şeyden evvel hazırlıklı olmak lazım teknik olarak. Böyle bir şey olduğunda da altyapımız, bilgimiz, ne yapacağımızı bilmemiz lazım. Evet değerli katılımcılar, ben göremiyor olabilirim ama ne chatten ne de soru kabulü gelmedi. Bu arada Bir şeyi de hatırlatmak isterim, duyurmak isterim. Biliyorsunuz bu sempozyumda sunulan çok değerli bildiriler var. Eğer bildiri sahipleri gönüllü olursa bunlar belli bir seçme ve akademik değerlendirmeden geçtikten sonra Biyoenerji Çalışmaları dergisinde yayınlanacak. Open source, yani açık bir kaynak. Bunu da takip etmenizi özellikle buradan hatırlatmak isterim. Haluk Hocam çok teşekkür ediyoruz.
Estağfurullah hocam, ben teşekkür ederim.
Oturumumuzun en son sunumuydu. Ama şunu ifade etmek isterim ki çok sayıda toplantıda bulunduk. 6 tane sunum, hepsi birbirinden güzel. Heyecan hiç inmedi. Sonuna kadar da takipte oldu. Ben özellikle sizlerin bize sağladığınız katkı için sizlere çok teşekkür ediyorum. Değerli konuşmacılarımızın tamamına. Katılımcılarımızın dinledikleri için çok teşekkür ediyorum. Sempozyum Düzenleme Kurulu'na özellikle de burada bize teknik destek sağlayan ekip arkadaşımıza, hem hanımefendi hem beyefendi gerçekten çeviride oldukça büyük katkılar sağladılar. Diğer teknik ekibe de teşekkür ediyoruz. Ve ben bir 5-6 dakikalık gecikmeyle oturumumuzu burada kapatıyorum. Daha sonra sağlıklı günlerde görüşmek ümidiyle. Hepinize hoşça kalın diyorum.
Değerli misafirlerimiz, 10 dakika ara veriyoruz. 10 dakika sonra tekrar buluşmak üzere.
Adını da sordum.
Gülnur Hocam, merhabalar. Sesim geliyor mu size?
Evet, geliyor.
Tagem'de bir elektrik gidip gelmiş sanırım. İnternet kopması yaşanmış. Bir iki dakika sonra başlayalım isterseniz. Şu anda katılımcılar geliyor salona. Eğer müsaadeniz olursa.
Olur.
Tamam hocam. Değerli katılımcılarımız, sempozyumumuzun öğleden sonraki ikinci oturumuna hepiniz hoş geldiniz. Öğleden sonraki oturumu yönetmek üzere ben lafı Gündür Hocamıza bırakıyorum. Buyurun Gündür Hocam.
Çok teşekkür ediyorum. İzmir'den Ege Üniversitesi Biyokütle Enerjisi Sistemleri ve Teknolojileri Uygulama ve Araştırma Merkezi'nden hepinize sevgiyle, saygıyla selamlıyorum. Ben öncelikle Tarım Bakanlığımız TAGEM'i ve de Karadeniz Tarımsal Araştırma Enstitüsü Müdürlüğü'ne, tüm çalışanlara ve de Güneydoğu'ya çok teşekkür etmek istiyorum. Böyle bir etkinlik planladıkları ve de bizleri bir araya getirdikleri için. Bugünkü oturumumuzda şöyle bir baktığımda daha çok biyorafineri süreçleriyle ilgili yaklaşımlarda bulunacak. Onu görüyorum. İlk konuşmacımız çağrılı bildiri sunacak bize. Ve son yıllarda özellikle hepimiz biliyoruz ki atık su arıtımı ve de arıtma çamurlarının sürdürülebilir kullanımlarında biyorafineri yaklaşımı son derece önemli. Ancak biyorafineri yaklaşımında göz ardı etmememiz gereken konulardan bir tanesi bu tarz çalışmaların teknolojik ve ekonomik performanslarının detaylı bir şekilde ortaya konması da bizim açımızdan son derece önemli. Bu anlamda ben ilk konuşmacımızın konusunu çok anlamlı buluyorum. Atık su arıtma ve çoklu biyokütle biyo ürün üretimine yönelik mikroalg ve sinobakteriya kullanım odaklı biyorafineri yaklaşımıyla ilgili bize bir sunum yapacak. Sanıyorum burada değil mi Muhammed Amer Mehmut?
Hocam şu anda salonda göremiyoruz kendisini. Ulaşmaya çalışıyoruz ama telefondan da cevap vermiyor kendisi. İsterseniz bir sonraki sunuma geçelim. Geldiğinde kendisine söz verelim.
Peki, zaten bir sonraki sunumda atık su arıtımı ve bu yöndeki teknolojilerle ilgili. Preum kumar biterdi burada mı acaba?
Kendisi burada.
Evet, o zaman kendisine söz verelim. Hindistan teknoloji enstitüsü
I'm
katılım sağlıyor ve bize gelişmekte olan ülkelerde geleneksel ve gelişen teknolojilerle atık su kullanarak biyoenerji üretimi konusunda bilgiler verecek. Sayın Prevent Kumar Vityarthi, sunum yapmak üzere sizi bekliyoruz. Öncelikle kendinizi tanıtırsanız da çok memnun oluruz. Tabii sabahtan beri onu da söylemiş olayım ben. Düzenleme kurulundaki arkadaşlarımız, teknik danışmanlarımız bu konuda hep uyarıyorlar. Sunum süremiz 20 dakika, 15 dakikası bildirinin sunulmasıyla ilgili, 5 dakikada soru, cevap ve katkılarla ilgili. Buna da sadık kalırsanız tüm konuşmacılarımız için söylemiş olayım, çok memnun olacağız. Evet, Sayın
Sure, ma'am. Thank you for your words. My name is Praveen Kumar Vidyarthi. I'm from India and working as a research PhD scholar in an institute of technology in Roorkee. So it's one of the pioneer institute in India right now, and it's been like 175 years of institution has a record. My work is more closely to the how we can get energy out of the wastewater treatment system. And it's like one of the most untapped resources till now. And thank you for the members and especially the jury members for allowing me and giving me an opportunity to present a paper on bioenergy generation from the waste treatment. So many people are thinking of how we can generate energy by bio crops and all the things, but ultimately we are have to focusing on something which is already freely available to us. We're growing something and then cutting it out and utilizing the food energy, we are somewhere hindering the food security itself. So my work is more, so I would like to present my start my presenting my work. I hope I'm audible clear. Can you confirm, someone confirm that I'm audible clearly? Hello? Yeah, thank you very much. My presentation is available now, I guess. Okay, the topic is bioenergy generation using wastewater through traditional and emerging technologies in developing countries. Why am I focusing on more on developing countries? Because the countries have huge potential and they are growing up. And with the growing, they have more industrial waste in their systems. And also, if you count the developed countries, they have also the huge population also, so which also generates lots of sewage waste also. So I will trying to connect you with the possibilities of which are traditionally using the traditional technologies and how do we get energy out of it, and also what are the emerging technologies coming up in the different scenarios. So what is water? What we say, how we defined it. Basically, so a substance that is present over 70% on the earth, normally what we say, and or maybe of someone who is technically viable, or maybe some who has more thoughts will say like 90 to 60% of the body weight component is water. But I don't think it's above that. It's an essential component commodity in every organism life, especially for the human beings to do the performance, basic performance task. So existence of the water, let's say we can't quantify that 75% of the earth is full of water, which is around 61 60 96.5% is non-drinkable and not fit for doing the basic task. So now the fresh available is just 3.5% of the fresh water. Out of that, 69% is ice cap, glaciers, and permanent snow, which cannot be used further. So we are left with just 31% of fresh water, which is approximately 1% of the total water exists on Earth. So it's serving that 1% is serving the 8 billion population on the earth. So it's a problematic thing. So we understand that by 2040, the around maximum countries living near the tropical or near the equator, or you can say tropical regions, are going to be in a huge stress of water stress. And because the development with the high development rate in the developing countries, they are pushing themselves beyond their limits to for the industrial growth, and it's creating lots of waste generation. So, and with the simultaneously, the reduction in the waste green fresh water due to the global warming is also turning up 3 billion population into water crisis now. So how does a potable water becomes a wastewater? Let's do a simple mathematical calculation. According to the Bureau of Indian Standard, per capita adult full flush system required 135 liters per day capita. And let's say we have four members in a family, it requires 540 liters of per capita water. So if I consider if the 10% loss is from the river pumped from water pumped from the Thames, and it's to get treated and supplied to the for domestic, so I get 900 liters of water treated and supplied to the domestic. Considering the fact the domestic, the countries, especially the developing countries, they don't have so much of good quality of transmission systems, so they have a losses of 40% around. So which accounts for, like, we lost 460 water liters of water per capita per day. And out of that, only 540 liters of water is transported to the system household. So, and for the roughly calculation, what we do is then we consider, like, what the water supplied to the home is about 80% is lost again to the sewage. The total amount which is calculated, quantifying of it, which is going to the treatment, sewage treatment plant, will be 892 liters of liters per day per capita. So overall, in 98% of water is again going to join the water river resource itself. So what we have done, we just have done utilize 10% of the water in our whole cycle, but rest is just wasted. And as it's also pressurizing our sewage treatment systems, overly over not harnessing the energy out of it. And we are misusing this potential energy. So this much essential component to for the mankind, how it's becoming so waste. So it's like not using it wisely, not judiciously used, not recycling it, and it all converts into gray water or black water. Problem associated with the wastewater is there are a huge amount of huge amount of nutrition removal required. Recombination is also required. Shrinking of water resources and growth and rapid growth of population and industries is there. And many of the countries, like India is one of them, has huge expense on just transferring the drinking water from one source to another. There was a solution we have. See, we have a recombination, understanding the water stress, understanding the water resources, innovation, and new technologies. But many people are saying, like, okay, we have already the solution, like microbial filters, variable filter solutions, and nanotechnologies and microfiber fuel cells. But these all technologies require a huge amount of energy itself. They are using your power, which is coming from the fossil fuel itself. So I don't think it's a viable solution. Why don't we use the water energy tapped inside the wastewater itself? So we have two solutions for that, which I focused on. So we can have, without touching the existing power SGV plants, which has already been designed for 30 years already, can be clubbed with different sources and can be utilized for generating energy. Or the new STP plants, which is coming up forward, can be combined with the heat and power transmission, and the harness of energy can be done by this. So what are the traditional technologies which we are using are generally aerobic process and anaerobic process. And maximum of the countries, developing countries, uses aerobic processes, which just treat the water and does not generate much of energy, but simply just putting forward the system process further. We can have an anaerobic process in it, and we can get energy out of it. So I will be showing some of the slides which will be referring to it. By coupling wastewater treatment plant with the microbial algae culture, which has a huge lipid content. So lipid content can be has a huge potential of harnessing biofuels, which can be biodiesel, bioethanol, and biohydrogen and combustible gases. And also in the return, it's also provide you bioremedies, which is like nutrition removal. Coupling with wastewater treatment plant with anaerobic digestion systems. Here I am talking about the different digestion systems, which is using of fluidized batch reactors. Then we have anaerobic sludge blanket reactors. So these type of things can be clubbed together with the existing plants, and we can have more energy generation. Industry and domestic waste are rich of organic waste, and then can be converted into hydrogen, methanol, and ethanol, and bioplastic generation. Further, they have also untapped hydrogen, which is coming up one of the most huge energy resource, which can be has a huge capacity to fulfill our need for the vehicular fuel. Further, the one thing which is always we call it waste is after a waste is also and turned into a waste, which is called slurry, has a huge potential of generation of energy, which can be through nutrition recovery, like recovery of phosphorus, bioplastics, proteins. These can be harnessed from them. And in the form of energy, we have a huge amount of fuel present. Syngas is one of them. Biogas is one of them. And also bio-oil is one of them, which can be harnessed from this energy source. Further, as I have mentioned before only, that by simple anaerobic digestion process, adding up can give us a huge amount of potential of supply of energy. As Indian being an agriculture-based economy, we have surplus of agriculture and forest in 500 metric tons of biomass available per year, which can be converted into huge biofuels and biochemical energy by simple thermochemical conversion processes. So one of the new technology which has been seen long before but has been coming up forward and has a huge potential also is this microbial fuel cell, which simultaneously generate electricity and methane at the same time, and by just simply integrating it with the existing plants can be have a huge output out of it. And also it has shown that potential of producing hydrogen energy and hydrogen gas also. So these is the overall application format which we have seen, like what all potential they have, and we come up with the applications in for the different fields. So some of them are that was the traditional what we can use for the existing plants. Now what we can do with the coming up plants, we have emerging technologies which have huge potential, which have energy condition, nutrition removal, and energy saving all the same time. So they can produce biogas, biosolid, hydrogen, removal of phosphate, nitrogen, and COD-BOD. So bioagglomeration is one of them. Bioagglomeration is the addition of the process of adding selected strain and mixing the culture to the wastewater treatment plants. And it can be a huge potential by cutting short the utilization of synthetic or inorganic fertilizers to 50 to 75%, and it can turn out to be one of the positive fertilizers which is generated from itself from the organic components, and it has less impact compared to the inorganic one. Further, it's also has shown that it has an enhanced removal efficiency of nutrition also. So second one is ghost coupling microbial algae and bacterial biofilms. It has shown the insignificant impact on removal of nutrients from systems, and also it saves lots of energy because it does not require any external energy sources for generating using this pond basically. So we get around 63% of COD removal and BOD removal of 80%, and ammonia removal of 64%, and phosphate removal of 95% just within 7 days of this. Further, we have algae-based wastewater remedies. So everyone has seen algae-based remedies, but this is one have shown more potential than compared to the other algae-based systems. So we have this simple pond which can help in removing the bio nutrition removal and also removal of heavy metals from the system. And it's the algae-based systems have more impact on water quality control and also water loss control. and this can further be utilized to send, get biomass, and which can be harnessed to get a biofertilizer out of it. Bioelectrocoagulation and flocculation is one of the basic techniques we already be using. Here we will be using a cathode. Here they have used a cathode of ferric and algae, which has using has required a current of 3 ampere and 1 ampere respectively, and it has shown a huge conversion rate and it, of converting that anaerobic reactors, getting them converted into biogas, and it has a removal percentage of 50% of COD also. And one of the untapped resource was in which I found is in the paper was the hydrogen bubbles for form. When we go, if in case we go for the large scale production, we can have a good amount of hydrogen generation out of it. And last not the least, there's a filamentary algae, which is more advanced than the macrogal algae due to the size, and it's easy to harness and retain. And it is it has overall low cost impact, and further it avoids the nutrition removal, and it can be useful as an waste generation of biomass itself. And this is the overall application, and which we can see that maximum them have already huge potential of nutrition removal and also energy resource.
Tamamlandı aslında. Toparlayabilirsiniz.
Seviniriz. Yeah, I'm done. Yeah. Thank you very much for listening patiently, and I'm open for the questions.
Çok teşekkür.
It's okay.
Çok teşekkür ediyoruz anlayışınız için. Evet, soru var mı acaba katılımcılarımızdan? Ben göremiyorum ama chatten de herhangi bir paylaşım olmamış. Ha. Evet. Şu an anketimiz de açıldı. Konuşmacımızla ilgili oy verme sürecini başlatabiliriz Sayın Midyarti ile ilgili.
Anket linkini paylaştık Gülnur Hocam. 5 dakika içinde katılımcılarımız cevaplayabilirler şu anda.
Evet, görüyorum. Katılımcılarımızdan konuşmacımızın değerli sunumuyla ilgili oylama bekliyoruz, görüşlerini bekliyoruz.
Ben müsaadenizle bir şey daha ifade edeyim hocam. Salonda şu anda 140 kişi var, ancak anketlere 15-20 kişi katılım gösteriyor sistemden incelediğimizde. Misafirlerimizin ankete katılım göstermelerini rica ediyoruz. Yani her ankette ortalama 15-20 kişiyle gidiyoruz şu an.
Bence de çok önemli, çünkü gerçekten katılımcılarımızın bu konuya hassas davranacaklarından ben de eminim. Çünkü sunumlarını hazırlayan araştırmacılarımız büyük gayret ve emekleriyle, özveriyle hazırlıyorlar, katılım sağlıyorlar. Özellikle bu oturumda yurt dışından katılımcılarımız da var. Bu konuda gerekli hassasiyeti açıkçası bekliyoruz. Umarım sayımızı arttırabiliriz.
Thank you everyone for listening. I should leave the floor now.
Biz de çok teşekkür ediyoruz verdiğiniz güzel bilgilerle ilgili. Çünkü bizim de ülkemiz gelişmekte olan bir ülke olduğu için gerçekten bizim açımızdan önemliydi. Özellikle atık su arıtmanın biyoenerjide kullanım olanaklarının artırılmasına yönelik paylaşmış olduğunuz bilgiler için biz size teşekkür ediyoruz.
Hocam, chatten bir soru geldi. Öyle mi? Olsun. Evet, Gülay Kızmaz tarafından.
Evet, Gülay Hanım buyurun lütfen. Konuşmacımız burada değil mi?
Evet hocam, burada şu anda bizi dinliyor.
Merhaba. Ben sorumu yazmıştım ama arıtma tesislerinde sadece suyun enerjisini mi kullanıyorlar onu merak ettim. Yeni bir teknoloji mi yoksa suyun enerjisini kullanarak mı arıtma yapıyorlar?
Evet. Konuşmacımız...
There are two types of fields I have tried to put forward. So basically, I'm using a wastewater treatment plant, which has already been existing itself in every country, I guess, have a wastewater treatment plant. So they are just trying to implement or couple something with that plant and get energy out of it. And many countries are looking forward to have better facilities for the wastewater treatment plants. And so we can integrate more of the new technologies, emerging technologies with them. And we can come up with them harnessing more on focusing on energy harnessing, basically. Basically, what had the policies been in developing countries just to treat the water. And we all know that that's a hard truth, like only 40 to 45% of the water is treated till now in maximum countries, not 100% water is treated. So if we have a potential to getting harnessing that energy also and simultaneously removing the treating the water also, we can have a good amount of energy, because if we are looking forward for the bioenergy generation, so it's one of the untapped energy which is freely available to us. We just need to implement simple things, while we need to be focusing on the land areas which are already been fulfilling the foods of the stomach of the people of the huge population, especially if I talk about the countries like India, which has a huge population. Their people are still starving, like, so we should not go for the crops like that by generating, by using the fields for, especially for generating bio crops. I think I answered my the question clearly. If you still have doubt, we can have a question again.
Evet, teşekkür ediyoruz. Gülay Hanım, yeterli midir?
Teşekkür ederim, yeterlidir. Ben onu merak etmiştim. Çünkü su çok kıt bir kaynak Hindistan'da da. Hani %40'ını kullanabiliyoruz dedi. Yani daha fazlasını kullanmak için yeni bir teknoloji mi geliştirdiler diye onu ben merak ettim.
Evet, peki. Çok teşekkür ediyoruz biz konuşmacımıza verdiği bilgiler nedeniyle. Sanıyorum diğer konuşmacımıza geçebiliriz. Anket tamamlandı zannediyorum, değil mi? Teknik sorumlu arkadaşımız.
Evet hocam, bir sonraki konuşmaya da geçebiliriz.
Evet, bir sonraki konuşmacımız ise yenilenebilir doğal karbon ve azot kaynakları ile endüstriyel atıklar ham madde olarak kullanılarak mikroorganizmalardan biyosöksenik asit üretimine yönelik bir çalışmasını bize sunacak. Kendisi Nebraska Üniversitesi'nden katılıyor. Sayın Lisbeth Valasila Yepez'i ben davet ediyorum. Aramızda değil mi?
Yes. Thank you so much. It's my pleasure to be here and now I'm going to...
Evet, kendinize... biz de çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Kısaca tanıtır mısınız? Sizi tanıyalım ve sonra sunumunuzu dinleyelim.
Okay. Give me a second. Oops. So, good morning, everyone. My name is Lisbeth Vallecilla Yepes. I'm a PhD candidate at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln here in the United States. I'm doing my PhD in the Department of Biological System Engineering. This is my third year. Today, I'm talking about my research project, bioproduction succinic acid from corn fiber hydrolysate by Actinobacillus succinogenes. This is a brief outline of my presentation. I'm going to talk about what is succinic acid and corn fiber. The research goal and specific objectives of my project, some results that we are obtaining so far, and some concluded remarks and future work. So what is succinic acid? Succinic acid is a 4-carbon dicarboxylic acid with significant production application in food, agriculture, pharmaceutical, and polymer industry. Succinic acid is a key role in the synthesis of chemical with significant markets. For example, 1,4-butanediol, which is a precursor for polyester, tetrahydrofuran, a precursor for polytetramethylene ether glycol, is also used in the production of gamma-butylolactone, a precursor for pesticide, and is also used in productions of coatings, surfactants, dye, perfumes, and lacquers. However, there are some issues in succinic acid production. Currently, succinic acid is obtained by a chemical process that uses petroleum as a starting material. His production includes multiple high temperature and high pressures. It uses heavy catalysts, heavy metal catalysts, and organic solvents, making the process environmentally questionable. Given the fundamental role of succinic acid as a chemical commodity and the concerns associated with petrochemical sources, there is a need for alternative sustainable process. It means a bio-based succinic acid production. Also in recent years, growing concerns over the contribution of fossil fuels to global warming and a strong demand for environmental friendly had inspired the interest in developing more sustainable ways. Succinic acid is an intermediate component of the tricarboxylic acid cycle and an end product of different bacteria. That's why it can be produced by microbial fermentation. Also, succinic acid was featured as one of the top value-add chemicals from biomass by the U.S. Department of Energy. The global bio-based succinic acid market is expected to witness a demand of 1,380 tons by 2023. So this is a basic comparison between bio-based and fossil-based succinic acid production. So we have we have here the biomass, and after some treatment and hydrolysis, we obtain the sugars to obtain succinic acid, and the conventional well is from petrochemical sources, maleic anhydride, and then we also obtain succinic acid. Bio-based succinic acid production has major advantages compared to the petroleum, such as the use of renewable road feedstock, carbon dioxide fixation. It also possesses a lower energy consumption, about 30 to 40%. However, there are some disadvantages like the lack of cost competitiveness and performance issues, lower material efficiency. The price of petroleum and political decision has significantly influenced the economic success of the bio-based platform. Nevertheless, to establish a successful industrial succinic acid bioprocess, all the following are necessary: the selection of an excellent production strain, the selection of economical carbon source, an improvement of reactor performance and productivities, and an efficient process for the recovery of succinic acid. Different microorganisms have been recognized as a high yield succinic acid producers in nature. Actinobacillus succinogenes is one of them. It's a native producer of succinic acid. It's a gram-negative facultative anaerobic non-motile and sporiform bacterium. Its optimal growth temperature is 37 degrees Celsius, and it also forms biofilms in long-term fermentations. Another advantage of this microorganism is that it can use a broad spectrum of carbohydrates, including monosaccharides, glucosylose, arabinose, and disaccharides, maltose, cellulose, sucrose. And it also uses mannitol and sorbitol under anaerobic conditions. It possesses high tolerance under osmotic pressure and high concentration of gluconate succinate. This feature making an excellent candidate for the industrialization of biosuccinic acid. Various renewable non-food biomasses, such as corn fiber, sugarcane bagasse, corn stover, industrial hemp, have been using to investigate succinic acid production from Bioactinobacillus succinogenes. In this work, we use corn fiber. So the process is the corn comes from the dry milling, and we use this, the company used this fiber separation technology to separate the starch. The fiber that comes from this process represents around 10% of the corn and is removed from the corn kernel. They do this in order to increase the fermenter capacity. This corn fiber contains low protein content. That's what is used primarily to feed cattle, converting it into a low value material. However, this corn fiber is rich in polysaccharides, and these polysaccharides can be break down into monosaccharides and fermented to produce succinic acid. Therefore, the research goal of our project is to develop an efficient process to produce succinic acid from corn fiber. And the specific objectives are to optimize succinic acid production from sugars found in corn fiber by a succinogenes. And the objective number two is to design a fermenter that utilizes egg succinogenes ability to form biofilms and maximize sugars and carbon dioxide transfer to bacteria in order to increase succinic acid yield and productivity. In this presentation, we will focus on an objective number one. So here we're gonna see some results. Corn fiber was obtained from a bioethanol industry located here in Nebraska, and the average composition analysis was carried out. We found that this corn fiber is rich in glucan. About 25% is also contains xylans and another minor sugars. This corn fiber possesses a low lignin content, which allow us to do a low severity pretreatment, such as liquid hot water. The protein content of this corn fiber is 19.3. So, but we did was an optimized condition for liquid hot water pretreatment. And then we did an enzymatic hydrolysis to maximize the sugars in corn fiber. The optimum corn fiber pretreatment parameters were found at 180 and 10 minutes. And the enzymatic hydrolysis was performed with 15% solids loading. We use cellulase as enzyme to release, to break down the glucan, and sodium citrate was used to as a buffer. Here is a general schematic procedure what we did. So we had the corn fiber, we do the pretreatment at 180, 10 minutes. After that, we separate solids and liquid prehydrolysis, and the solids are subjected to enzymatic hydrolysis. We obtain the solution, we contain the sugars, and the sugars are fermented to produce succinic acid. So in the next part, what we did was a fermentation of that solution. So in that, here in this picture, we can see this is our control. This is the corn fiber that possesses this brownish color. The carbon source that we have was the control again. And then we have do the variations here because what we did is pretreat only the solids and do the enzymatic hydrolysis, the enzymatic hydrolysis of the solid, but in other part what we did was add liquid prehydrolysis to the pretreated corn fiber. So that's what we had to control and two different hydrolysis. We use yeast extract as a nitrogen source, magnesium carbonate as a pH regulator, and experiment was performing a shaker for 150 RPM until receiving degree. This is the first graph that we obtained. So we can see here that the control and also the hydrolyzer are consumed to produce succinic acid. Succinic acid is this in the fermentation, we also found the formic acid and acetic acid are produced. When we combine the liquid and the solid, we see that in the hydrolysis, the consumption is very low. So we suspect that could be inhibitors that come from the pretreatment. But again, succinic acid was produced too, and formic and acetic acid. We also found that this bacteria consumes sodium citrate, that because we suspected, we use sodium citrate for the enzymatic hydrolysis, so we suspected it consumed a little bit. So yes, we found that the bacteria, even if the literature report that it doesn't have citrate lyase or something, this bacteria consumes sodium citrate to produce principally acetic acid, but also produce succinic acid and formic acid. Then what we did next was to change the buffer for we're not using sodium citrate now, we're using sodium acetate and then we found the same, like, the bacteria use the sugars in the control, but also in the hydrolysis and produce a lot of succinic acid. We also did another modification, was to add buffer to one of the control to mimic the same what is happening in the corn fiber hydrolysis, and we obtain similar succinic acid concentrations. So as a concluding remarks, well, we found that corn fiber hydrolysis produced by optimized liquid hot water pretreatments and enzymatic hydrolysis condition produce succinic support succinic acid production by Actinobacillus succinogenes. We found that in the control, the succinic acid produced are around 28.7 grams per liter with a yield of 0.67. The theoretical yield is 1.12. In the hydrolysis, the succinic acid concentration was 27.8 with a yield of 0.61 gram of succinic acid per gram of sugars. And also, we found that the succinogenes metabolize sodium citrate to produce acetic acid as well as succinic acid and formic acid. As a future work, we want to produce a corn fiber hydrolysis from both cellulose and hemicellulose in order to improve the efficiency of the whole process. We use the prehydrolysis, but we found some inhibitors. So we are looking to find a way to reduce those inhibitors, and we can ferment all the solution and add also silanes to break down the silos, because this corn fiber is rich in silos. And we also are constructing a bioreactor, and we want to evaluate bioreactor parameters to increase succinic acid productivities and yield in this process. Thank you very much. And if you have any question, I will be happy to answer.
Gündür Hanım, sesiniz kapalı şu an.
Kendi kendime konuştum o zaman. Biz de çok teşekkür ediyoruz genç araştırmacımıza. Süreyi de çok iyi bir şekilde kullandı. Tam zamanında bitirdi. Salondan soru alabiliriz varsa. Şu an için ben göremiyorum ama.
Şu an herhangi bir soru yok hocam.
Herhangi bir soru yok. Yine anketimizi başlattık, değil mi Sayın Yepez'le ilgili? Katılımcılarımızın, genç arkadaşımızı desteklemesini bekliyoruz açıkçası. Evet. Çünkü konusu son derece ilginçti. Son yıllarda özellikle biyoenerji çalışmalarında Biyosükselik asit elde edilmesine yönelik ham madde de üzerinde duruluyor. Bu anlamda da biyokütlenin çoklu ürün yaklaşımıyla sunumunu hazırlamış olması, doktora çalışmasını bu yönde yönlendirmiş olması bizim açımızdan da önemli. Ama soru var mı bakıyorum. Sanıyorum çok detaylı anlattınız. Salondan da o konuda herhangi bir soru gelmedi. Anketi ne kadar tutuyoruz?
Normalde 5 dakika tutuyoruz efendim.
5 dakika tutuyoruz. Evet.
Ama eğer isterseniz siz bir sonraki sunuma geçebilirsiniz. Bu süreçte ben 5 dakika dolana kadar formu açık tutarım.
Olur. İsterseniz öyle yapalım. Evet. Bir sonraki konuşmacımız. Ana Mendoza Nerio, kendisi sorgum küspesiyle ilgili bir çalışmasını bizlere aktaracak. Hepimiz biliyoruz ki tarımsal endüstri atıkları artık ham madde olarak özellikle biyorafineri yaklaşımıyla değerlendirilme bazında önemli durulan konular arasında. Hem enerji üretimi hem de biyo ürün elde edilmesi açısından önem taşıyor. Bu konuyla ilgili olarak da Sayın Ana Mendoza Nerio sorgum küspesini ele almış ve hidrotermal ön işlemle biyomas fraksiyonunu belirlemeye çalışmış. Evet, sizi dinleyelim. Buyurun.
Thank you so much. Please, could you indicate...
Kendinizi tanıtabilir misiniz? Kısaca size tanımış olalım biz de bu arada.
Okay, thank you so much. Well, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ana Mendoza. I belong to biorefinery group here in Autonomous University of Coahuila, here in Mexico. And today we're going to present the next topic. Well, talking a little bit about ourselves, we come from Saltillo, Coahuila, here in Mexico. Saltillo is a small city in at the north of the Mexico, and near to United States, and is considered the Detroit of Mexico because of the importance of its automotive industry. Actually, the biorefinery group is active in our Autonomous University of Coahuila. And what is the principal purpose of our group? Well, the group is active in different aspects of biorefinery process, which include use lignocellulosic and aquatic biomass for the production of biofuels and compounds with high added value through the integration of clean process as endothermal processing, taking into consideration environmental aspects based in the context of bioeconomy. Looking in general terms of biorefinery, the classification of biorefinery is very important. This classification follows what kind of feedstocks the biorefinery process are made. We have three generations. The first generation that use food crops like sugar cane or corn. Second generation use non-food crops like waste, come from forest, food or agro-industrial. And finally, the third generation that use marine crops like macro or microalgae. All this kind of material are introduced in a biorefinery process in order to produce a bioproducts like energy, materials, or chemicals. What is the principal objective of this investigation? Well, this investigation are focused in the second generation of biorefineries, the one that use wastes. These kind of wastes are also known as lignocellulosic biomass. This kind of materials has the characteristic to have three different elements in their chemical compositions. There are cellulose, hemicellulose, and lignin. One example of lignocellulosic biomass is a sorghum bagasse. This kind of material, we are working with this kind of material because here in Mexico, annually, like around 2 million of metric tons are produced. And other advantage to use lignocellulosic biomass is the availability through the year and the low commercial value. It is considered a waste, so the price is very, very low. This study are focused in the bioconversion of biomass to lactic acid. And what is the process that we are following? Well, we have the raw material that is sorghum bagasse. And the process starts with a size reduction. First, the material is need to dry in ground and sift. And after we have a particle size. The first stage of the process are hydrothermal pretreatment, or also called autohydrolysis. In this investigation, we are working with three variables, that is time, temperature, and solid liquid ratio. At the end of this part of this stage, we are focused in order to produce glucose, xylose, arabinose, furfural, and acetic acid. What is the concentration after the hydrothermal pretreatment? For the next two stages are saccharification and fermentation. It is important to mention that these two stages could take two ways. One way is an independent or an individual way for an individual. And we can apply some operational strategies that are simultaneous saccharification and fermentation. What are the advantages to apply operational strategy? Well, the principal advantage is if we perform this kind of bioprocess in industrial scale, we can reduce the time of the process. But if we apply this kind of operational strategy, it's important to check before that the enzymes and the microorganisms involved in these operations works in a different condition, especially with the temperature. And after that, we have the purification, and finally, we obtain our product, in this case, the lactic acid. The hydrothermal pretreatment are a fundamental part of this process. Why? Because this stage plays an important role because allows the fractionation of the main components of lignocellulosic biomass. And what is the fundamentals of the hydrothermal pretreatment? Well, the principal advantage to apply hydrothermal pretreatment is environmental friendly process. Hemicellulose is solubilized and depolymerized. The low byproduct generation like inhibitors as furans and no chemical other than water are necessary. Calcium localization of lignin on the surface of lignocellulosic material. But how the hydrothermal pretreatment are work? Well, we have the system. We can see in the screen. We have the system, and we only add water and our material, lignocellulosic biomass or aquatic biomass like macroalgae. We have a 50% of liquid phase, and the other 50% are steam. The equilibrium is thermodynamically favored by the temperature and the pressure. These processes are called or are known as autoionization. Why? Because the action of the water at high temperature and at high pressure, we favorize to autoionization of the water, and they convert into hydronium ions that act as a catalyst. So we have a autohydrolysis. But it's also need to mention that here in the system, we form acetic acid. This acetic acid comes from acetyl groups of hemicellulose part, especially talking about lignocellulosic materials. Here in the biorefinery group, we have different hydrothermal reactors. We can see in the screen, these are two. We have four different volumes, but all work with a proportional integrative derivative controller. We have another helping sources for the hydrothermal pretreatment that are steam and microwave. And the variables that always we need to take into account, are severity conditions, particle size, and ratio liquid. How the severity conditions are measured? Well, we have one important thing to mention is the severity factor. What is the severity factor? It's a dimensional factor that allows knowing the severity with which the process is carried out. This consider a heating and cooling temperature profiles in hydrothermal processing. And finally, we have two isothermal regimens. One is non-isothermal regime that not consider any time of in the stage, and the other is isothermal regimen that consider time during the pretreatment. And we also have like in the graphs. And what is the expected results for this particular work or investigation? First, achieve the optimization of the pretreatment and fermentation process for the production of lactic acid using sorghum bagasse. And during the saccharification stage, obtain a high concentration of glucose, which can be fermentable and obtain a product in its pure form. A previous investigation, we applied hydrothermal pretreatment, but in aquatic biomass. What was the results of this investigation? The results are shown in the screen, and we have all the experimental design that we carry out. We can conclude that at the severity factor of the highest severity factor in this case, we have a highest concentration of glucan of 40% of this material. This investigation carried out in order to produce bioethanol. The results were compared with another study with El Rio. They performed with the same condition at the same temperature. They obtained a lower concentration of this element of the glucan. And why is this possible? Because the kind of material, the gender of our algae, in the characterization part, present a highest concentration of sugars in comparison to sargassum that has a lower concentration of sugars. In the next response phase graph, we can show that the effect of the hydrothermal pretreatment time and temperature at the highest concentration we have in this part, the highest concentration of glucan that we recover. And then the saccharification and fermentation part in order to produce bioethanol, we apply semi-simultaneous saccharification and fermentation. And this graph represents the production kinetics using this operational strategy. We can see the 24 hours, we have the saccharification part. In this part, the enzymes do its work. And after that time, the production of sugars start to reduce. And what we can conclude of this part, at the 72 hours, we have the maximum concentration of production of ethanol. And the result that we have was the maximum glucose concentrations were 12%, the maximum ethanol concentration were 5%, and the ethanol yield were 33% in this investigation. The results were compared with another two authors, Lee and Aparicio. They performed the same study with another gender of macroalgae. And they have, what was the result? They have a maximum ethanol and concentration yield higher than our investigation. We can, this is because of the type of enzymes cocktail. We need to prove another enzyme cocktail mix because it's very important after hydrothermal treatment, use the a good microorganisms and enzymes in order to have a maximum concentration of glucose and ethanol in order to have a good ethanol yield. So what are the conclusions? General conclusions, the wastes and aquatic biomass has the potential to be a competitive resource to produce high added value compounds. And hydrothermal pretreatment turns out to be an efficient method for the polymerization of different biomass. And this is all for my part. Thank you for your attention.
Biz de çok teşekkür ediyoruz verdiğiniz bilgiler için. Bu konuda soru var mı acaba? Salondan. Anketi açtık mı acaba?
Evet hocam, anketi paylaştık şu an.
Evet. Yine katılımcılarımızın desteğini bekliyoruz. Sayın Ana Mendoza Nereo için. Bu oturum biyorafineri çalışmalarıyla ilgiliydi genel anlamda. Şimdi yavaş yavaş herhalde biyoetanole doğru geçiş yapacağız. Ama biraz anket için beklemeliyiz. Belki soru var mı diye beklemeliyiz. Ben bu arada bir bakayım var mı chat bölümüne. Şu an için herhangi bir soru görünmüyor.
Doğrudur hocam. Herhangi bir soru ya da söz hakkı isteyen kimse yok şu anda.
Peki ne yapalım? Devam edelim mi?
Devam edebiliriz hocam. Anket misafirlerimiz anketi oylamaya devam edebilir 5 dakika süre içerisinde. Biz diğer sunuma geçebiliriz.
Peki o zaman evet, konuşmacımız da yormadan diğer sunuma geçebiliriz. Diğer sunum ikinci nesil biyoetanol üretimiyle ilgili. Sayın Öznur Yıldırım yapacak. Zeytin ağacı biyokütlesinin biyoetanol üretiminde kullanımına yönelik farklı ön işlem metotlarını bize anlatacak. Tabii ben bu anlamda TAGEM'e çok teşekkür etmek istiyorum. Bize ikinci nesil biyoyakıtlar ve ön işlemlerle ilgili bu konuda destek vermişlerdi. Proje desteği Hüseyin Akyol'u da görüyorum bu arada. Bu vesileyle ben de kendilerine teşekkür etmiş olayım. Benzer bir konuda projemizi biz TAGEM'in fonlamasıyla tamamlamıştık. Evet, Sayın Öznur Yıldırım, sizdeyiz, sizi dinliyoruz.
Buyurun herkese lütfen. Merhabalar. Ben Öznur Yıldırım, Yıldız Teknik Üniversitesi Çevre Mühendisliği. Bir şey mi dediniz acaba?
Hayır Öznur Hanım, devam edebilirsiniz. O çevirmen arkadaş diğer kanalda.
Tamam, pardon. Yıldız Teknik Üniversitesi Çevre Mühendisliği bölümünde çalışıyorum. Burada yaptığım küçük bir çalışmayı anlatacağım aslında. Zeytin budama atıklarının etanol potansiyelini değerlendirmiştim son zamanlarda. Ondan küçük bir bölümü anlatacağım ben size. Ama öncelikle biz üniversitemizde kendi ekibimizle ne gibi çalışmalar yapıyoruz? Kısaca ondan bahsetmek istiyorum. Bu sempozyum genelde biyokütle üzerinden olacağını düşündüğüm için zeytin atığı da son yeni yaptığım bir şeydi. Ondan bahsetmek istedim. Onun özelinde hazırlamak istedim. Fakat diğer yaptığımız bütün çalışmalarda aslında biyoenerji içerikli bizim. Yani ekip olarak bu konuya ağırlıklı çalışıyoruz. Pamuk sapı olsun, ayçiçeği sapı olsun, dediğim gibi zeytin sapları olsun, organik atıklar, muz atıkları vesaire birçok atıktan, atık su, atık çamur gibi biyometan üretimi, biyohidrojen üretimi, biyoetanol ve biyobutanol üretimi üzerinde çalışıyoruz genel itibariyle. Aynı zamanda yakıt hücreleri konusunda da hem makine mühendisliği hem malzeme mühendisliğinden hocalarımızla ortak çalışmalar gerçekleştiriyoruz. Hatta amonyak yakıt hücresiyle hidrojen üretimi çalışmalarına da yeni yeni başladık. Onun dışında laboratuvarımızda bir fotobiyoreaktörümüz var. Atık suda alg üretimi gerçekleştiriyoruz. Hatta ürettiğimiz alglerden onları hasat ettikten sonra alg biyokütlesini yine fizik bölümünden bir hocamızla beraber yakıt güneş pillerinin verimini arttırmak için kullanımını gerçekleştirdiğimiz bir proje gerçekleştiriyoruz. Onun dışında biyogaz arıtımı, biyogaz saflaştırma gibi konularda çalışıyoruz. Yine yeni başlayan bir projemiz var. Biyolojik sülfür giderimi gerçekleştiriyoruz. Haloalkali şartlarda bunu da mikrobiyal olarak yapıyoruz. Aynı zamanda geçen yaz Tuz Gölü'nden almış olduğumuz mikroalg numunelerimiz vardı. O mikroalglerden de mikroalgal beta karoten üretimi üzerine çalışmalar yapıyoruz. Yine bunu da bunlar yüksek tuzlu ortamlarda beta karoten üretimi arttırdıkları için ters ozmoz çıkış suyu, konsantre suyunda yani yine atık suda beta karoten üretimi gerçekleştiriyoruz. Lignoselyozik atıklarla alakalı olarak yaptığımız çalışmalara bakarsak geçen sene yine Ankara Üniversitesi ile ortak olarak yaptığımız bir ABE fermentasyonuyla etanol ve butanol üretimi projemiz vardı. Burada Clostridium türü mikroorganizma ile etanol ve butanol üretimi gerçekleştirmiştik karanlık fermentasyonla. Burada yine pamuk sapı, ayçiçeği sapı ve sazlık gibi lignoselyozik atıklar kullanmıştık. Ben şu an doktora yapıyorum. Yüksek lisans tezimde de bu konuyla alakalı çalışma yapmıştım. Orada da maya kullanarak etanol üretimi gerçekleştirmiştim. Yine tezim kapsamında response surface metodoloji, yüzey yanıt metodolojileriyle en uygun pretreatment şartlarını bularak onun üzerine maksimum etanol üretimi nasıl olur bunu çalışmıştık. Ülkemizde ben şu an bu çalışmada kullandığım zeytin saplarını ben Balıkesir'den kendim toplamıştım Edremit'ten. Zeytin hasadı döneminde çok fazla miktarda zeytin dalı, zeytin yaprağı gibi atıklar çıkıyor. Bunlar şu an mesela Balıkesir'de son bildiğim kadarıyla yaprakları çay olarak değerlendirmek için topluyorlar oradaki yerli halk ve bunu paketleyip satmaya başladılar. Diğer katı kısımları ki ben de onu kullandım, odunsu partını kullandım. Odunsu kısımlarsa genelde pellet yapmada kullanılabiliyor, yakmada ve kompostta kullanılabiliyor. Kompost içinde bu katı kısımları alıp gübreyle birleştirerek kompost üretimi gerçekleştiriyorlar. Bunu yine tarımda kullanıyorlar. Fakat burada yakmaya baktığımız zaman örneğin dönüşsel biyoekonomi kapsamında yakma bir atık yönetimi olarak görülmüyor. Ama halk daha çok bunu yakmada kullanıyor. Hani diğer prosesler daha kapsamlı olduğu için eline geleni yakarak kullanıyorlar ki bunun yapılmaması gerekiyor. Ben de bu atıkların bir etanol potansiyeline bakayım demiştim. Zaten çalıştığım bir konu olduğu için. Peki biyoetanol ve biyobutanol üretiminin amacı ne? Biz genelde bunların hepsini çalışıyoruz. Hidrojen, etanol, butanol. Fakat bunun asıl amacı ne? Yani bütün bu çalışmaların. First generation biofuels yani yenilebilir gıda kaynaklarından üretilen biyoyakıtlara baktığımız zaman bunların karbondioksit üretim miktarları, örneğin etanolün 1.92 kilogram karbondioksit bölü kilogram yakıtken, butanolün 2.37 kilogram karbondioksit bölü kilogram yakıt. Fakat benzin ve dizele baktığımızda bu değerler daha yüksek. Yani etanol ve butanolün araçlarda yakıt olarak kullanılması durumunda çevreye salınan karbondioksit azalıyor. Ki first generation biyoyakıtlarda bile azalmış oluyor diğerlerine göre. Second generation yani lignoselyozik atıklardan türetilen biyoyakıtlara baktığımız zamansa bunu Alternative Fuels Data Center diye bir internet sitesi var. Oradan baktığımızda lignoselyozik atıklardan üretilen etanolün yakıtlarda, araçlarda yakıt olarak kullanılması durumunda sera gazı emisyonlarının %108'e kadar azaltılabileceğini söylemişler. Bu da şöyle açıklanıyor. Bu lignoselyozik atıklar büyürken zaten karbondioksit tükettikleri için ki zaten saldıkları karbondioksit de benzine göre daha az olduğu için %108'e kadar sera gazı emisyonunun azalabileceğini söylüyorlar. Benzine kıyasla baktığımız zamansa hidrojen kullanımında zaten sadece buhar, su buharı açığa çıktığı için herhangi bir karbondioksit salınımı yok. Etanol kullanımında ise benzine oranla %42 sera gazı salınımı azaltılmış oluyor. Butanolde bu %28 oluyor. aslında butanol üretimi baktığımız zaman etanola göre daha avantajlı olmuş oluyor. Lignoselülozik atıkları zaten biliyoruz. Bir önceki sunumlarda da arkadaşlarımız anlatmıştı. Kısaca yine de bahsedeyim. Birinci jenerasyon dediğimiz yenilebilir gıdalar, ikinci jenerasyon dediğimiz odunsu atıklar, yani lignoselülozik atıklar. Bunu da yine daha önce arkadaşlarımız söylemişti. Düşük maliyetli olmaları, food chain'le yani besin zinciriyle çakışmamaları ve sürekli bulunabilir ve bol olmaları sebebiyle lignoselülozik atıklardan etanol üretimi oldukça popüler. Fakat lignoselülozik atıkların kompleks bir yapısı olduğu için, selüloz, hemiselüloz ve ligninin karmaşık bir yapısı olduğu için bunların önertme yapılmadan kullanılması çok mümkün olmuyor, özellikle mikrobiyal olarak. Çeşitli önertme prosesleri sonucunda bu lignoselülozik yapı içerisindeki selüloz, hemiselüloz, lignin matriksi kırılarak mikroorganizmaların bu selülozu kullanabilir hale gelmesi sağlanıyor. Önertme çeşitleri de genel olarak fiziksel, kimyasal, fizikokimyasal ve biyolojik olarak ayrılıyor. Fiziksel önertmeyi genelde aslında birçoğumuz uygulamış oluyoruz. Çünkü odunsu bitkiyi aldığımız zaman bir şekilde küçültmemiz gerekiyor kullanabilmek için. Daha sonra bazıları kimyasal da ekliyor, bazıları kimyasal eklemeden sadece buhar patlatma gibi fiziksel prosesleri uygulamaya devam edebiliyor. Yine aynı şekilde biyolojik prosesler de var, bakterilerin ve mayaların kullanıldığı. Özellikle biz de rumen bakterilerini de aslında kullanarak çalışmalar yürütüyoruz. Burada yaptığım çalışmada, bu sempozyum için yaptığım çalışmada zeytin atıklarını topladım önce. Daha sonra kuruttum ve bunları öğüttüm. Öğüttükten sonra 3 farklı önertme prosesini denemek istedim. Daha önce yine zeytin atıklarıyla yaptığım bir çalışmada da yine yüzey yanıt metodolojilerini kullanarak özellikle aset için, sülfürik aset için en uygun şartları belirlemiştim. Burada gördüğünüz %1 konsantrasyonda sülfürik asit 120 santigrat derecede 20 dakika otoklavlama prosesi benim daha önce yüzey yanıt metodolojisiyle bulduğum en uygun şartlardı önertme için. En yüksek şeker içeriğine ulaşmak için. Aynı şartları kireç ve sadece otoklav, yani buhar patlatma olarak da denemek istedim. Bunları otoklavda önertme yaptıktan sonra farklı farklı asit, kireç, ya asit, alkali ve buhar patlatma olarak katı sıvı faz ayrımını gerçekleştirdikten sonra sıvı fazı kullandım. Sadece hidroliz atık kullandım. Katı fazı zaten böyle direkt kullanmamız mümkün değil. Katı fazı önce enzimatik hidroliz de yapmamız gerekiyor. Önertme sonucunda hem sıvı fazda hem katı fazda şeker içeriği bulunuyor. Bunların indirgen şeker miktarını ölçtüm. Daha ayrıntılı bir şeker analizi yapmadım. Sadece indirgen şeker miktarı olarak ölçtüm. Buna baktığım zaman saf ham olive tree biomass'te, saf ham daha doğrusu zeytin atığında 8 miligram bölü gram atık şeker bulunurken asitle önertme yaptığımda bunun 420 miligrama kadar çıktığını gördüm. Alkali pretreatment'ta ise 211, sadece buhar patlatmada ise 105 civarında kaldı bu şeker içeriği. Dolayısıyla yüksek ölçekli olarak, bunlar küçük ölçekli yapmıştım. Büyük ölçekli olarak asitle önertme yapılmış hidrolizatı daha sonra fermentasyonda kullandım. Fermentasyon için yine tezimde kullanmış olduğum Saccharomyces cerevisiae türü mayam vardı elimde. Önce bu stok kültürümü YPD medyasında aktive ediyorum. Daha sonra bir fermentörümüz var. Orada 3,5 litre çalışma hacminde çalıştım. Otomatik pH'ını ayarladım. pH'i 5 ve sıcaklığı 30 santigrat derece olacak şekilde 72 saat boyunca fermentasyona devam ettim. Bu en uygun şartları da daha önceden bulmuştuk. Ön arıtmadan sonra oluşan hidrolizatın çok düşük bir pH'i oluyor. Özellikle asit pretreatment yaptıktan sonra hidrolizatın pH'i çok düşük oluyor. O yüzden önce bir pH ayarlaması yapıyoruz fermentasyona başlamadan önce. Daha sonra büyüttüğümüz mayayı da ortama ekleyerek 72 saat fermentasyona devam ettik. Sonra çıkan numunemizin içindeki alkol miktarını gaz kromatografiyle ölçtük. Şimdi burada teorik olarak zeytin atığından ne kadar etanol elde edebilirdik, gerçekten ne kadar elde ettik, bunu karşılaştırmak istedim. Teorik olarak bu denkleme baktığımızda 1 gram şekerden 0,51 gram etanol üretimi sağlayabiliyoruz. Bu 0,42 gram şeker 1 gram zeytin atığından dediğim bizim bulduğumuz değerdi. Bizim bir önceki slide'da gösterdiğim ön arıtma sonucunda 420 mg bölü gram olarak bulduğumuz sonuç buna eşdeğer. Yani en iyi şartlarda ön arıtma yaptığımız zaman 0,42 gram şeker elde edebiliyoruz. Bu durumda da bir tondan 215 kilogram etanol üretimi sağlayabiliyoruz. Bu teorik olarak, yani maksimum verimde. Bizim sonuçlarımıza baktığımız zaman kullandığımız hidrolizatın konsantrasyonu olarak şeker miktarı 41.7 gram bölü litreydi. Çalışma sonucunda elde ettiğimiz etanol miktarı 14.20 gram bölü litre. Bu durumda gerçek verim olarak 1 gram şekerden biz teorikteki gibi 0.51 yerine 0.34 gram etanol üretimi sağlamış olduk. Ve ton başına kıyasladığımız zaman bir ton zeytin atığından 143 kilogram etanol üretimi sağlamış oluyoruz ki bu teorikte 215 kilogramdı. Sonuç olarak baktığımızda ikinci nesil biyoyakıtların aslında önemli bir kaynak olduğunu görüyoruz. Yani bunları bir şekilde ülkemizdeki regülasyonlara da baktığımız zaman en az %5 zaten şu an etanol kullanılmış olması gerekiyor yakıt olarak, benzine ilave olarak. Dolayısıyla ve ülkemizde birçok firmada şu an mısırdan üretiliyor. Yani şeker kamışı ve mısır kullanılıyor etanol üretimi için. Yani bir noktada lignoselülozik atıklardan da etanol üretiminin gerçekleşmesi gerekiyor. Seyreltik asiti en uygun ön arıtma metodu olarak bulduk biz bu çalışma sonucunda. Bu sonuçlarda etanol üretimine bizi yönlendirmeli diye düşünüyoruz. Ama tabii bunların daha endüstrileşebilmesi için teknoekonomik analizlerinin de yapılması çok daha önemli olacaktır. Çünkü hepimizin bildiği gibi bu ön arıtma prosesleri aslında çok maliyetli prosesler. Teşekkür ediyorum.
Evet, biz de çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Gerçekten ikinci nesil biyoyakıtlardan etanol üretimi son derece önemli. Ama tabii burada, hani ben de zaten soracaktım ekonomik mi diye. hem teknik hem de ekonomik anlamda analizlerin yapılması çok önemli. Özellikle biyoyakıtlarla ilgili çalışmalarda bunu hep böyle gözümüzün önünde dikkate değer şekilde tutmamız gerekiyor. Hani hep deriz ya attığımız taş ne kadar ürküteşek diye. Çünkü açıkçası o anlamda benim de çekincelerim var. Hani ekonomik anlamda. Çünkü analiz yaptığınız zaman bazı engellerle karşılaşabiliyorsunuz. Ama İkinci nesil biyoyakıtların da mesela zeytin atıklarının bu anlamda değerlendirilmesinde önemli bulunuyor. Ekonomik olması yönünde belki bundan sonraki çalışmalar hedeflenebilir, neler yapılabilir fazında. Çünkü şu an için kuşkusuz ekonomik çıkmayacak. Evet, ben soru var mı diye yine katılımcılara soracağım, soru ya da katkı. Yine Öznur'la ilgili, Öznur Hanım'la ilgili anketimiz başlatıldı. Katılımcılarımızın desteklemelerini bekliyoruz. Bu oturum da çok keyifli oldu. Genç araştırmacılarla birlikte ve de deneysel çalışmalarını hep bize aktardılar. Çünkü sempozyumlarda bazen onu göremiyoruz. Ama bu anlamda ben çok teşekkür ediyorum TAGEM'e. Gerçekten çok nitelikli deneysel çalışmaların bu platforma yansıtılmasını sağlamışlar. Büyük emek harcamışlar. O anlamda çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Evet, bakıyorum soru var mı diye ama soru yok zannederim. Yine biraz bekleyelim belki o arada. Sanıyorum biz yine devam edelim. Sizi de daha fazla yormayalım. Çok teşekkür ediyoruz verdiğiniz bilgiler için.
Ben teşekkür ederim.
Bu vesileyle tanışmış olmaktan da çok keyif aldım. Bütün konuşmacılarımıza aynı şeyi söyleyebilirim. Son konuşmacımız Selim Özgür. Sayın Özgür, farklı kimyasal ön işlemlerinin pamuk sapının şeker üretimi ve dip içeriğine etkilerini bize anlatmaya çalışacak. Evet, buyurun.
Hi everyone. My name is Sevim Özgül. I am chemical engineer and PhD candidate in energy technology at Ege University Solar Energy Institute. My supervisor is Prof. Dr. Gunur Koçar, and she is also director of Biomass Energy System and Technology Application and Research Center. Today, I will present the fiber degradation and sugar production by different chemical pretreatment methods of cotton stalk. The content of my presentation is introduction, material and method, result and discussion, conclusion. As everybody knows, fossil fuel as a non-renewable energy source has a serious negative effect both environment and life. Thus, it becomes mandatory to find an alternative. At this point, development country aim to transition from fossil-based economy to bioeconomy with sustainable development targets by considering future generation. Lignocellulosic biomass has a complex internal structure. It is comprised of number of major components, and cellulose is one of the main structure of it. In this context, cellulose has received increasing attention due to its abundance, and easy accessibility, low density, biocompatibility, excellent performance, thermal stability, and environmental benefits. Cotton stalk is an agricultural residue rich in cellulose and hemicellulose, and it is a potential material for bioethanol production through proper pretreatment, hydrolysis, and fermentation. Also, cotton stalk is used for biocomposite production as a fiber. Cotton stalk material. Cotton stalk was obtained from a field in Izmir. Cotton stalk were separated in 2 millimeter particles size by the seeds. Seaweed sample were used for thermal assistant alkali pretreatment, microwave pretreatment, and hydrochloric acid pretreatment. Before we start, what is the pretreatment of biomass? We can see from the figure the structure of the lignocellulosic material outside of its lignin, and inside there are hemicellulose and cellulose. Hemicellulose is an amorph structure. Cellulose has both amorph and neat structure. The logic behind of the pretreatment to break down the lignin to reach the hemicellulose and cellulose, it depends of the purpose of the study. Before we start, we have to know what is our raw material. So there are some basic analysis to understand what is our raw material and which process is much more suitable for the conversion. Thus, approximate analysis was done according to TS1562. Ultimate analysis was conducted, and it is determined carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, sulfur content. And calorific value, a high heat value according to ASTMD 5865. In this study, let's start with the thermal assistant alkali pretreatment. Alkali pretreatment or mercerization is one of the most used chemical pretreatment for lignocellulosic biomass. Alkali pretreatment provides disruption of hydrogen bonding in the network structure and remove acetyl and various uranic acid substitution on hemicellulose. Also, removing of lignin from biomass is the major effect, thus providing improving the reactivity of remaining polysaccharides. Based on the literature, alkali pretreatment has two main effects on fiber production. First, it increased surface roughness, resulting in better mechanical interlocking. And the second is it is increasing the amount of cellulose exposed on the fiber surface, thus increasing the number of possible reaction sites. In this study, raw material were immersed in sodium hydroxide solution, 3.57% weight per volume. Alkali-free treatment were performed at 60 degrees Celsius, 90 degrees Celsius, and 120 degrees Celsius, with residence time 1, 2, and 3 hours in an oven. The suspension was further filtered. The residue was washed with distilled water until the filtrate was 7. After that, the filtrate fibers were dried at 80 degrees Celsius for 12 hours, and then put in slit press plastic container for further analysis. Also, the hydrocytes were collected and stored at 4 degrees Celsius. Microwave pretreatment, based on the literature, microwave pretreatment studies focus mainly three applications. First, polysaccharide release for the ethanol production. Second, phenolic molecules release. Third, energy production. While microwave treatment can provide the lignification process quickly, it needs a lot of energy. Besides, microwave pretreatment enhances the biofuel production, and it used for the surface modification of the hydrophilic fiber production. In this study, the pretreatment was performed at different in time interval, 15 minutes, 30 minutes, and 45 minutes at various temperature, 80 degrees Celsius, 100 degrees Celsius, and 120 degrees Celsius, using dilute sulfuric acid, 1 to 2% volume per volume. All experiments were carried out at fixed load, 20 milliliter sulfuric acid solution and 2 gram cotton stalk in a flux, using microwave instrument at 60% efficient and 1,600 watt power. The suspension again was filtered. The solid residue was washed several times until the pH reached 7. And again, filters start dried at 80 degrees Celsius, 20 hours, and hydrocytes stored at 4 degrees Celsius. Hydrochloric acid is one of the most effective pretreatment methods for lignocellulosic biomass. Through this pretreatment, hydrolysis of hemi cellulose occurs and monomeric sugar and soluble oligomers released from the cell wall matrix into the hydrocyte. Removing of hemi cellulose, increasing porosity, and this situation improves enzymatic digestibility too. Also, dilute acid pretreatment is one of the most chemical treatment for natural fiber production. In this study, hydrochloric acid pretreatment was carried out with fixed load, solid load, 100 milliliter hydrochloric acid solution and 3 gram cotton stalk in each flux. The experiment was carried out in an oven at 90 degrees Celsius, 105 degrees Celsius, 120 degrees Celsius, reaction time 1 to 3 hours, and hydrochloric concentration 1, 3, and 5 percent weight per volume. Again, the same procedure for the suspension was further filtered. Solid part is washed with the distilled water until the pH was 7, and then dried at 80 degrees Celsius, 12 hours, and then hydrocyte stored at 4 degrees Celsius. HP analysis to determine monosaccharides and its degradation products. The hydrocyte was filtered through 0.25 micrometer membrane, which was then directly analyzed by agent 1260 infinity HPLC with NMAX Biort HPX 87H column based on NRAS standard. Fiber analysis of cellulose, semicellulose, and lignin content of fiber was carried out according to method of bond soils. About 1 gram of sample was ground in the powder, and the content of neutral detergent fiber, acid detergent fiber, and acid detergent lignin respectively. were extracted by the by a series solution and solvent. Through formula conversion, the content of cellulose, hemicellulose, and lignin was obtained. Here we see the properties of raw cotton fiber. As we see from the table, the carbon content is 41.52, hydrogen 5.91, and moisture is 12.90. It is higher than the literature because newly harvested cotton fiber was used. And height heat value is 4043.93. And hemicellulose 46.53, hemicellulose 5.8. In this figure, we see the results of the total sugar, glucose, cellulose, xylose, arabinose concentration of thermal alkali pretreatment. As we see from the figure, the highest value is 9.98. Gram per liter, and the experiment condition was 90 degrees Celsius, 3% sodium hydroxide solution, and 1 hour. Here we see the result of fiber analysis of solid residue after thermal assisted alkali pretreatment. We can see the highest value is 64.12, and the experiment condition is 120 degrees Celsius, 5% sodium hydroxide solution, and 3 hours. Also, we observed that with increasing the in temperature, the cellulose content is also increased. Here, box Banken design and analysis of ANOVA. The response surface methodology was used for the optimization of cellulose amount. The total number of experiments required was provided as 15 rounds, which include 3 center point by state is design expert software. At the end of the experiment, the experimental data were fitted to the second order polynomial model in order to express the interaction between response variables and independent variables. Analysis of various was used test the fit of the final model to evaluate experimental result. As we see from the table, p-value is smaller than the 0.005. It means the model is significant. And also independent variables, which are A is concentration, B is temperature, C is residence time. A, B, the interaction between concentration and temperature. A, C, interaction between concentration and residence. And BC is interaction between temperature and residence time. Also, we use a 3D surface plot were used to evaluate the influence of the independent variables on the cellulose and interaction between 3 independent variables such as temperature, sodium hydroxide concentration, and residence time. This figure showed the effect of interaction between temperature and concentration on cellulose amount. And it was observed that the amount of cellulose decreased with the increase in temperature and increase in concentration. And this figure showed the effect of interaction between residence times and temperature on cellulose content. And it was observed that the amount of cellulose increase at low temperature and low residence time. Here, microwave sulfuric acid pretreatment. The table showed the total sugar concentration of hydrolysates of microwave pretreatment cotton stock. And we see the highest value is 84.60 gram per liter. And the experimental condition is 120 degrees Celsius, 1% sulfuric acid solution, and 30 minutes. Microwave is an efficient method in terms of degradation and solubilization of extracellular polymers, and it observed that the total sugar content is high. Here we see the result of fiber analysis of the solid residue after microwave sulfuric acid treatment, and the highest value is 62.54, And the condition, experiment condition is 100 degrees Celsius, 1.5% sulfuric acid concentration and 30 minutes. Again, here is the ANOVA of the Bax-Behnken design for the microwave sulfuric acid pretreatment, and P value is smaller than the 0.05, and the model is significant. A is for the independent variables. A is temperature, B concentration, and C resistance time. It's similar with the previous slide. A, B is the interaction between temperature and concentration, AC temperature and resistance time, and BC concentration and resistance time. Here we see the effect of the concentration and effect of interaction of concentration and temperature on cellulose production. It was observed that the amount of cellulose reached its maximum value and decreased from the peak of peak point. And the peak point of the graph has low temperature and a concentration of about 1.5% sulfuric acid. And this figures show the effect of interaction between resistance time on and temperature on cellulose content. And it was observed that the amount of cellulose was higher at the low resistance time and temperature. This table showed the total sugar concentration of hydrocytes of hydrochloric acid pretreatment, pretreated cotton stuff. And we see the highest value is 36.58 gram per liter. And the experiment condition is 120 degrees Celsius, 3% hydrochloric solution and 3 hours. It is seen that glucose, xylose, arabinose sugar in hemicellulose structure are largely broken down, and also it was observed that cellulose was degraded under high temperature and acid concentration, such as 100 degrees Celsius, 5%, and 2 hours, 105 degrees Celsius, 5%, 3 hours, and 120 degrees Celsius, 3%, and 3 hours. Here we see the result of fiber analysis of solid residue, residue after hydrochloric acid pretreatment, and the highest value is 62.96, and the experiment conditions 90 degrees Celsius, 3% sulfur hydrochloric acid solution, and 1 hour. And also we conduct the optimization for thermal assistant alkali pretreatment and microwave pretreatment. Independent variables such as temperature, concentration, and residence time were optimized to maximize the amount of the cellulose. For the thermal assistant alkali treatment, variables were kept in range, and cellulose result from the experiment lower limit is 49.76%, upper limit is 64.12%. According to these optimization criteria, 90 solutions were generated. The maximum value of desirability function, which was 1, was obtained at 119.62 degrees Celsius, 6.36% sodium hydroxide concentration, and 2.7 hour residence time. Thus, Bax-Behnken optimization solution for cellulose for thermal assistant alkali pretreatment is 65.3876%, and it is similar with the microwave sulfuric acid optimization. And again, variables were kept in range. Cellulose from the experiment, the lower limit is 51%, upper limit is 62.54%, and the maximum value of desirability function, which was 0.926, was obtained at 93.79 degrees Celsius, 1.59% sulfuric acid concentration, and 26.09 minute Max Planck optimization solution for cellulose for microwave sulfuric acid pretreatment is 61.6859%. Conclusion. In this study, through different pre-treatment methods, cotton stalk was evaluated to increase the amount and accessibility of cellulose, also increase of the sugars. Cotton stalk can be used as a reinforcement material for biocomposite production, and also it can evaluate for the bioethanol production. For this purpose, thermal assistant alkali pretreatment, microwave pretreatment with sulfuric acid, and hydrochloric acid pretreatment were performed by varying temperature, reaction time, and concentration. The results show that all pretreatment methods increase the cellulose content and sugar content as well. According to the result, while microwave pretreatment was the most effective method for total sugar production, both alkali and hydrochloric acid pretreatment has the same highest result for the cellulose. This study is evaluated as a first stage of the bioethanol and biocomposite production, and it is aimed to contribute to following studies. Here is some of my reference, and thank you for your attention and listening.
Evet. Biz de teşekkür ediyoruz. Biraz süreyi aştık. Ben son konuşmacı olduğu için, bir de ilk konuşmacımız da gelmediği için açıkçası müdahale etmek istemedim. Çok teşekkür ediyoruz Sayın Özgül'e.
Ben teşekkür ederim hocam.
Herhangi bir soru ya da katkı var mı katılımcılardan? Herhalde yok. Sevim için de anketimiz açıldı. Sanıyorum çağrılı konuşmacımız gelmedi, değil mi?
Hayır hocam, gelmedi kendileri. Ulaşamadık telefonla da kendisine.
Anladım. O zaman herhalde yavaş yavaş okulunu kapatmak durumundayız. Ben tüm katılımcılara ve de konuşmacılarımıza çok teşekkür etmek istiyorum. Gerçekten verdikleri değerli bilgiler için, özellikle oturum biyo atıkların, biyokütle kaynaklarının biyo rafineri yaklaşımıyla değerlendirilmesine yönelik bir oturumdu. Tüm araştırmacı arkadaşlarımın konuşmaları da birbiriyle ilintili ve birbirine destek nitelikte arka arkaya sunumlarını gerçekleştirdiler. Ben bu anlamda çok teşekkür etmek istiyorum. Yine TAGEM'e teşekkür ederek bu oturumu sonlandıralım. Gerçekten verdikleri katkı, özveri ve biyokütle alanında çalışan özellikle genç araştırmacılarımızı bir araya getirdikleri için ben kendilerine ayrıca çok teşekkür etmek istiyorum. Çünkü akademik yaşamlarına özellikle yeni başlamış arkadaşlar için bu tarz platformlar çok etkili. Onların önünü açması, gerekli işbirliklerin oluşturulması ve de yaptıkları çalışmaların duyurulması açısından son derece önemli. Bu anlamda böyle bir imkan tanıdığınız için ben genç arkadaşlarımızın da sözcüsü gibi olayım. Çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Yarın tekrar ikinci günde aynı heyecanla sunumları izlemeye sizi davet ediyoruz. Ben çok teşekkür ediyorum herkese ve bu oturumu kapatıyoruz. Herkese iyi çalışmalar. Umarım bundan sonra tekrar yeni işbirlikleriyle, yeni konularla bir arada olma imkanımız olur. Evet, hoşça kalın. Çok teşekkür ediyorum herkese.
Biz de teşekkür ederiz hocam. Sizin de emeğinize sağlık.
Çok olun. Evet.